day one of the new Democratic Congress. All the Democrats are sworn in, and it's a beginning of a new dawn. I mean, if you look at how the media portrayed this, it was fresh faces galore, diversity, beautiful diversity, diversity of the radical left, because it turns out that all the Democrats had to do when they took office was not be completely insane, and they just couldn't do it. It's truly amazing. If you look back at the last days of the 2018 campaign, the key question in the 2018 campaign was going to be, who were voters going to focus on? Were they going to focus on the foibles of the Republicans, or are they going to focus on the myriad stupidities of the Democrats? In the aftermath of the Judge Kavanaugh hearings, where Democrats proved themselves to care nothing about due process or decency, Republicans skyrocketed in the polls because all the focus was on how terrible the Democrats were. And then President Trump shifted the topic from Judge Kavanaugh to the caravan and to his border policies. And suddenly the focus was on Republicans, and people decided they didn't like the Republicans, and they ran screaming from the Republicans, and Republicans ended up losing the popular vote in the House by 8.6 percentage points. The same thing happened in 2016. The question was, is the focus on Hillary or is the focus on Trump? When the focus was on Trump, Trump went down in the polls. When the focus was on Hillary, as it was at the very end of the election, in large part thanks to James Comey's memo, at that point, the focus shifted to Hillary Clinton and Hillary Clinton lost. Well, in 2020, whoever the focus is on is going to lose, because it turns out that Americans hate both parties. Americans think that both parties stink. Americans hate these politicians. And so whoever they are focused on at that moment, whoever the public eye of Sauron alights upon, is going to be in trouble. So all the Democrats had to do for 2020 was just keep the focus on President Trump. They can't do it because they're crazy. And it turns out that their agenda is radically to the left, radical left. They're not bringing up any serious policy proposals. They're not bringing up any serious measures to alleviate the problems that America is experiencing. They're not unifying Americans around common values or decency. Instead, they're going to be just as crazy as they can be. And the media are going to celebrate them for it. The media are going to talk about how wonderful they are for being incredibly radical. So Nancy Pelosi takes the gavel yesterday as Speaker of the House after 8 long years in the wilderness. She is back. And her first thing is that she says that she's going to tackle climate change. Okay, if we are going to actually look at the priorities that Americans care about, climate change is not in the top 10. Climate change is not a major priority for Americans, specifically because if you look at the statistics, America's carbon emissions have actually been dropping in recent years. U.S. carbon emissions declined to a 67-year low in 2017. The U.S. power generation sector cut emissions by 28% since 2005. The U.S. is meeting its Paris Climate Accord targets despite having left the stupid agreement in early 2017. Right? All that's happening, and Americans are not deeply concerned about climate change because they do recognize that in reality, technological change is going to outpace all the sort of socialistic cram downs that Democrats want. Nonetheless, Nancy Pelosi targets climate change as her chief priority, and she's not the only one. Bernie Sanders was saying climate change is a top priority. Hank Johnson was saying that climate change is a top priority. Democrats across the board are saying climate change is their top priority. That's where you're going? Really? To climate? Well, here's Nancy Pelosi doing it yesterday.
The existential threat of our time, the climate crisis, a crisis manifested in natural disasters of epic proportions. The American people understand the urgency. The people are ahead of the Congress. The Congress must join them. And that is why we have created a select committee on climate crisis. The entire Congress must work to put an end to the inaction and denial of science that threaten the planet and the future.
Okay, if you really think that this is what the American people are looking for, you're out of your mind, and the Democrats campaigning on this is crazy. It's particularly crazy when you have people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who has thrown out what she calls a Green New Deal. Okay, her Green New Deal document that she put out yesterday is fully crazy, but she has been touted by the media as a leader in the Democratic Party. Okay, it's not my fault that the media decided to choose a complete ignoramus as the face of the new Democratic Party. It's not my fault. Okay, that's the fault of the Democrats and the fault of the media. And that means it is now incumbent on us to take whatever crazy ideas she has seriously. Now, what she actually is a crazy loonbag socialist. She was a member of the Democratic Socialists of America. Here are the details of her Green New Deal that she put out. Okay, this is nuts. Here's what she says. The proposed rule change for the upcoming 116th Congress would require the creation of a select committee for a Green Deal that would be responsible for creating a plan by January 1st, 2020, with corresponding draft legislation soon after. The text of the rule change lays out the committee's jurisdiction and required areas of action. Its scope and mandate for legislative authority amounts to a radical grant of power to Washington over Americans' lives, homes, businesses, travel, banking, and more. So what exactly are they looking for? What is she looking for? Their goal is to meet 100% of national power demand through renewable sources. Okay, by like 2030. By 2030, she wants 100% renewable power sources crammed down by government. Let me explain how insane this is. Okay, here is America's energy consumption by energy source for 2017, which is the latest data available. 37% of America's energy consumption came in the form of petroleum. Another 29% came in the form of natural gas. Another 14% came in the form of coal. Another 9% came in the form of nuclear electric power, which the Democrats don't like. 11% of America's energy supply came from renewable energy. So in other words, the growth of America's economy, the growth of the world economy, which is dependent on the growth of America's economy, is powered 89% by sources of energy that Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez doesn't like. It's just ridiculous. And by the way, even when we talk about renewable energy, okay, wood constitutes 19% of that. Okay, so that's not quite as renewable as people want. That has carbon emissions. When you use wood for fuel, that actually does have carbon emissions. Solar represents 6% of the 11% that is renewable energy. Wind represents 21% of the 11%. In other words, solar and wind and hydroelectric represent something like 5% of the total energy supply of the United States. She wants it to be 100% by 2030. How is that going to happen? Through massive taxation and quashing of the American economy. That's how it's going to happen. But it doesn't stop there. The document also states that the Green New Deal will advance non-environmental projects such as social, economic, racial, regional, and gender-based justice. What a Green New Deal has to do with gender-based justice is beyond me. I don't know what the hell that's even supposed to mean. Doesn't matter. She says that we should have a national energy-efficient smart grid. I'd like her to design it. Right? Since she's obviously an expert in energy management, you know, more so than people in coal and natural gas and petroleum, probably she should design it, right? I mean, she's a government expert. She was bartending until 5 seconds ago. But clearly, if there's one person who knows how to build a national energy-efficient smart grid, and that's not just a mashup of a bunch of words that sound nice together, it would be somebody like Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez, whose combined brain power could maybe provide the electricity to lightly toast a piece of bread. As long as we're talking about people providing renewable sources of energy. Okay, so I'm going to go through the rest of her plan, and then I will tell you how she plans to pay for all of this. So she says we should upgrade every residential and industrial building for state-of-the-art energy-efficient comfort and safety. That's not going to cost any money. We're going to retrofit every building in the United States with all this stuff. Eliminating greenhouse gas emissions for manufacturing, agriculture, and other industries. How? You know, how is a good question. It's a really useful question. How? Why? Right? These are useful questions in politics. She says, funding massive investment in reducing existing greenhouse gases. But that's not all. The proposed committee would also have seeming total oversight of American industry with a mandate for pushing union membership. So it's not just that we are going to green the economy through the force of government. We are going to unionize every industry to green the economy through the force of government. If this sounds a lot like the government controlling industry from the top down and destroying the economy, that's because it's precisely what it is. She wants a national jobs force to help people participate in the transition to the green economy. She says the Green New Deal will provide all members of our society across all regions and all communities the opportunity, training, and education to be a full and equal participant in the transition, including through a job guarantee program to assure a living wage job to every person who wants one. So let me get this straight. We could have the government take over all the industries and regulate them down to the ground, unionize all the industries, guarantee the employment through all the industries, and redistribute income for gender-based justice through all of this. Have we ever tried anything like this before in human history? Yes. Has it worked out super well? No. It turns out people like their property. It turns out that people are fans of being able to create. People like being entrepreneurs. People like working in creative areas. People like freedom. Freedom is a nice thing. And beyond that, obviously, this is going to destroy the economy. I mean, it's just immoral for her to suggest that innovation is dying and therefore we have to cram it. What has she ever invented? Has she invented a thing? I mean, granted, she like does Instagram instant pot cooking lessons. Ooh. But has she ever created like a job? Has she ever hired anyone? You know, not with government money at her congressional office, but like an actual job. Has she ever like produced a product or a good or a service anyone wanted to buy? And yet she's going to be running the economy. Perfect. Perfect. Also, she says that the plan includes fail-safes in the form of income, universal income and Medicare for all. Those are like the side projects that they're going to be working on in their spare time. Universal income and Medicare for all. Yeah, This isn't going to go wrong in any way. So Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez puts out this plan. And then she's asked, she's on 60 Minutes. Remember, she is the new face. She's the new face. Not my fault. You picked her, morons. Okay, so she's the new face. And here's what she says. She is asked, so how are you going to pay for all of this? Her answer, of course, is we are going to raise taxes massively on the rich.
Sometimes you see tax rates as high as 60 or 70%. That doesn't mean all $10 million are taxed at an extremely high rate, but it means that as you climb up this ladder, you should be contributing more.
What you are talking about, just big picture, is a radical agenda compared to the way politics is done right now. Do you call yourself a radical?
Yeah, you know, if that's what radical means, call me a radical.
Okay, well, I will. You're a radical. You're an insane radical. And when she says, oh, thank you for explaining marginal tax rates to me, Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez. Now, what would be awesome is if she explained how much money the people in the top quintile of the United States pay in federal income tax. Okay, here is the latest statistic. This is from April of 2018. Okay, for 2018, the reality is that top earners will pay the overwhelming majority of all taxes in the United States. Houses in the top 20% will have income of about $150,000 or more, and 52% of total income, they will pay 87% of all income taxes. 87% of all income taxes are paid for by the people in the top 20% of income earners. But by the way, it's worth noting here that America has the most progressive tax system in the entire industrialized world. Okay, that if you're, and when I say progressive, I mean the more money you make, the more money you pay. This is truer in America than it is in any of the European countries that Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez is talking about. The reality is that in order to pay for all of her god-awful, terrible, regulatory, economy-crushing programs, she would have to raise taxes radically on people who are lower down on the income scale. And when you hear people like Bernie Sanders say things like, well, back in the day of JFK, the top marginal tax rate was 91%. Why cannot we do that now? A few quick notes about this idiotic point. Number one, the top marginal tax rates in the day of Eisenhower and JFK was indeed 91%. But that was for people who earned, filing jointly, $3.4 million in inflation-adjusted dollars. The top marginal tax rate in the United States today kicks in at about $400,000. Okay, so not the same thing. Two, even that 91% top marginal tax rate was never paid for by anyone. The effective tax rate for people making that amount of money in 1955 was about 45%. Why? Because everybody was shielding their income because of the lower corporate tax rate, and also because until at that point, you were actually allowed to deduct on your taxes depreciation on all loans and depreciation on all real estate. So people just weren't paying that tax rate is the reality. And the economy was good because people weren't actually paying that tax rate. For every year between 1952 and 2014, the government brought in between 17 and 20% of GDP in tax revenue and between 7 and 9% of GDP in income tax revenue. So it's just a lie to suggest that taxes used to be so high and the economy was awesome when the taxes were super duper high. People just weren't paying them. They just were not paying them. If you really believe that you can do this to the tax rates and that magically everything will be okay, you're an idiot. All the proposals they're talking about, these Medicare for All studies, Guy Benson put this together a few months ago. He talked about how to raise tax rates to pay for AOC's and Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All nonsense. And here's what he came up with. Here's what you'd have to do. You'd have to raise the payroll tax paid for by workers and employers by 10 percentage points for everyone. Okay, for the workers and the employer, so that's a 20% increase, impose a brand new 20% national VAT sales tax, and hike income tax rates across the board for poor people, middle-class people, and rich people by 10 percentage points. Not one of those, all of those. All of those. This is why, if you look at all the famed socialistic countries, these supposed socialistic countries that the Democrats like to talk about, the Norways and the Denmarks, the average tax rate across the board is exorbitant, exorbitant. People are paying 60% of their income to the government of Denmark when you make over $60,000 a year in Denmark. And that does not include the national sales tax, which means that when all is said and done, like 80% of your income is going to the government of Denmark. Does that sound awesome to you? Do you think that might have an impact on, you know, how business works in the United States? Now, it's always easy, always to look at these Democrat socialist countries in Northern Europe and say, well, look, their economies are still working fine. You know why they're working fine? Because everyone on planet Earth is reliant on the economic strength of the United States. When the U.S. hits a depression, the rest of the world hits a depression. The economy is interconnected. It's why China right now is having economic problems, and it's going to affect the U.S. markets. If the U.S. has economic problems, everyone goes down the crapper. It's easy to survive with a population of 6 million and exorbitantly high tax rates a homogenous population of 6 million, you can survive if you've got the float of the United States bolstering the world economy. All socialism does is redistribute the gains made by capitalism. But it's slightly a different thing when there is no backup plan. What happens when the U.S. economy tanks because of all these myriad stupidities being pushed by the radical left in terms of policy? So that's their big plan. So their big plan is this new Green Deal, big spending, Medicare for all, free college for all. We're going to do all of these grandiose things that cost exorbitant amounts of taxpayer dollars and are wrongheaded in the extreme as well. You know, that when it comes to their college free for all plan, they say, well, you know, we could pay for that by just raising taxes a little bit and we'd pay for the education. We don't need more people going to community colleges to get degrees they don't need. What we need is more people going into careers that are useful. The idea that college is inevitably driving income is just wrong. Correlation does not equal causation there. The bottom quintile of college degree earners is earning less than the top quintile of high school degree earners, meaning that you can have a high school degree and still make a good living in the United States if you're willing to move up to Montana and work in oil rigging. But apparently we're not allowed to talk about any of those things anymore.